Good morning, guys. It's good to see you again for the talk on Wednesday. And Dr. Adams asked me to give a historical talk. I think I gave you a talk almost a year ago. So the first part, the first 10, 15 slides are similar. And then we go to a new topic, which is the history of valvular heart disease. And as we have a great interest here about mitral valve disease, there is a more specific focus on the history of mitral valve disease. As you know, without the knowledge of anatomy, there is no medicine. And without the knowledge of blood circulation, there is no cardiology. So let me just, I don't have any disclosure, set you the background. And the background, I think you heard that last time. I love this slide that described the blood motions according to Galen, who was the last great Greek physicians. And that's the knowledge that came from the antiquarian Greek medicine to the European Renaissance. And just let me spend a couple of minutes about the description of the blood motion according to Galen, because everything then unraveled through this basic knowledge. A lot of the discoveries of Galen were based on the, laser on dissections of animals, as you can see on the right side. The philosophy of Galen was based on the spirit, and he described three spirits. One is the natural spirit, one is the vital spirit in the heart, and then is the animal spirit, which is the soul in the brain, located in the brain. According to Galen, the food was ingested and then digested into the chyle, which was absorbed in the liver and mixed with the natural spirits. And that was the source of nutrient for the body. And through the venous systems, the natural spirits was taken to the entire body. Then the impurities was also drawn to the venous systems, and they brought back to the liver. And the part of that through the venous system was going to the right ventricle. And he described small pores inside the ventricles. And most of the impurities were going out through the pulmonary arteries, through the lungs. But some part was going through the septum to the left side, and the air was coming through the lung, through the mitral valve, and the mixture of the blood through the right ventricle and the air was forming the vital spirit. And the vital spirit through the arterial system was taken to the body, and that was the source of heat and energy for movement. So he basically described two parallel movements, and the movement of the blood inside the arteries and inside the vein was an ebb and flow movement, like in the ocean. So he didn't know there is a circulation, obviously. And then the mixture of vital spirit, as it was very hot, it was going backward through the mitral valve. And by breathing, some of the heat was actually expelled through the body through the process of breathing. So basically, he described lungs as a cooling bath to the heart. So basically, based on his knowledge, the valve has a relative incompetency. And he described that the mitral valve was more incompetent than the other valves, because the mitral valve has two leaflets, the other valves have three leaflets. And again, that is very important to note, that the air was coming through the mitral valve, mixing with the blood, going through the right ventricle to the left ventricle. And the mixture, as it was so hot, some part of it was going backward to get rid of the heat. And this is his theory of disease. It's called humoral theory of the diseases. It comprises four elements, which are blood, phlegm, yellow bile, and black bile. And they are correlated with some elements in the nature, fire, earth, water, and air. And according to the weather, it could have been hot, dry, cold, and wet. And an imbalance between these two elements was causing the body not to tolerate and to become sick. So this is basically the knowledge that came to the Middle Ages in terms of motion of the blood and theory of the disease. And a lot of it, obviously, in terms of theory of the disease, are based on superstitions. Then comes the New Age, which is toward the end of the Middle Ages. And at that time, we have a removal of the restrictions on the dissection of human body. And the first cases of dissection starts in end of 14th century, early 15th century. And I'm going to some of the books which were published at that time. This is the first modern books of anatomy, which was published in 1478. The first edition was a manuscript in 1316. And it went almost through 15 editions, manuscript and publications. The interesting thing, the work of Mondino de Luzzi, who was an Italian, is this drawing, which is historical, because you have the teacher that is teaching Galenic concept of disease and all the things that we have learned in medicine from Galen, and prosectors were dissecting the human body. And the prosectors were actually barber surgeons. They were quite uneducated people. So the importance of this book is that this is the first anatomical book of the modern ages. That was followed by Ketam Fasciculus Medicinae in 1491. This is the first anatomical book which has medical illustrations. Before, there was no medical book with illustration. This has 20 woodcuts. And as you can see, they were not very original sometimes, because the concept of the frontispiece, all these books have the first page which is drawing, which is called frontispiece. Is the same thing. The professor is reading the teaching of Galen, and the prosector is dissecting the human body. That takes you, and again, among the 20 woodcuts, you have these two on the abdominal organs and on the thoracic organs. And as you can see on the right side, Galen describes the heart as a two-chamber structure. There was a right ventricle, left ventricle, and the septum. And the right atrium was the prolongations of the superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. And the left atrium was a prolongation of the pulmonary veins. And when we get to the European Renaissance, the first illustrations of Da Vinci also draw the heart as a two-chamber structure. And he put the small holes in the septum. I think I showed it to you last time when I gave the talk about the anatomy of the heart. So here is the revolution. This is the guy who revolutionized medicine. It's Andreas Vesalius, who actually described and wrote the most important anatomical book of the European Renaissance, which starts from 1500 to 1650. He studied medicine in Paris and Belgium, and then he went back, and at the age of 23, started writing several anatomical books. But the most important one is the De Humani Corporis Fabrica, which means on the structure of human body. It has 200 woodcut anatomic illustrations, all done by Kalkar. Kalkar was a pupil of Titian, which was one of the greatest painter of European Renaissance. And what is his contribution to multiple? But the most important one is the following. Here, this medical illustration. And what it shows is that Vesalius is doing the dissection himself, and the prosectors are hiding below the table. And his teaching was the teaching of anatomy, or the knowledge of anatomy, should come from the dissection of the human body by the doctors, not by the prosectors. And that was the beginning of the science of observation, saying, don't believe what you have been told by Galen from 1500 years ago. Do the dissections, find anatomic structures, and describe it yourself. So in terms of, again, if you look at the comparison between the two drawings, the teacher is sitting up there, the prosector is dissecting. Here, the professor is dissecting. The prosectors are hiding below the table. Now, I show you just a few anatomic illustrations. Compare that with the Ketam from 1491. It is 1543, 15 years later. And look at how more detailed is the description of the thoracic organs and the vascular systems. There are about 12 woodcut of illustration of heart and cardiac valves and other structures. I just put a few of them. This is the third and the fifth illustrations of heart, the anterior view and the posterior view. And this one is the illustration number 7 and 9. On the left side, you have the right ventricle and the tricuspid valve. And you can see the leaflets quite clearly, the subvalvular apparatus, the papillary muscle, the attachment to the ventricular wall. And on the right side, you have the left ventricle and the mitral valve. And in what is specific to us in terms of contribution of Vesalius is twofold. The most important one is that he is the first author in the history of medicine that questions the galenic concept of blood motion, and he's the one who rejected the existence of pores in the septum. So that is the first stone that takes us to the knowledge of the blood circulations, as it will be described in 1628 by Harvey. So in the first edition on 1543, he questioned the existence of these pores, but in the second edition, which was published in 1555, he definitely rejected that there is no hole in the septum, there is no blood going from right side to the left side. But he still describes the heart as a two-chamber structure. He didn't describe the right atrium and left atrium properly, and he also believed on the description of the blood motions by Galen, because he didn't have any other alternative. As you may know, I'm sure most of you know also, he named the mitral valve based on the shape of the mitral, which looks like a meter of a bishop, but that's another topic. The second steps that takes us to the discovery of the blood circulation is the work of Colombo. Dorealdo Colombo was also an Italian. He became he was a pupil of Vesalius, and he became the chair of anatomy at Padua in Italy, which was the center of medical education. He wanted to have a lot of medical illustration based on Michelangelo to beat his boss. But the problem was Michelangelo refused to do these illustrations, and that didn't work out. As you can see, the work was published 6 months after he died, but the frontispiece is very similar to the frontispiece of Vesalius, where you can see the professor is doing the dissection, and you know, you see people around him in the anatomical theater, which were very fashionable at that time. So the contributions of Colombo are twofold. Colombo did a lot of vivid dissection. He dissected more than thousands of animals when they were alive. And he has a section, Do Viva Sezione, and one of his major contributions was the fact that he was the first to say there is no air coming to the left atrium. Left atrium is filled with blood. There is no air in the left atrium. And he's credited with the descriptions of the pulmonary circulation. And he's the first author who put on writing the fact that the valve inside the heart allowed the blood to go in one direction. And this is the text I show, read for you a little bit, the first two lines. Two of them have been constructed so that they carry blood inwardly to the heart. That is when the heart is dilated, that means diastole. But the two carry blood outward when the heart is constricted, that means in systole. There is a more detailed description, but that's the first author describing the function of the valve in one direction. Now, Colombo has been criticized to be a plagiarist. And you may ask me, you know, who said Colombo described this, or who described the work of Vesalius. There are different, I forgot to tell you, in medical bibliography. The most important medical bibliography is Garrison Morton. There are other words like Redford, Wellcome, Osler, but this is the Bible of medical bibliography. The first edition was in 1910. There were two historian Americans, one of them was a physician, and they basically went through the entire history for years and years to see who described first what phenomenon. And then it went through multiple editions, with the fifth edition, which came up in 1990 and was written by one of my friend, Jeremy Norman. And that's based on that, and this is a very respected, you know, references, at least it's the Bible of references in medical bibliography. So Garrison Morton actually described in their work, there are about two, three sentences about each author, that Colombo probably plagiarized the description of blood's pulmonary circulation because it was known by Ibn Nafis in 12th century, who was an Arabic physician, and also was described by an author called Michel Servetus in Spain in 1555. So, but again, history gave him credit in terms of description of the pulmonary circulation. The next author that is relevant to our topic in terms of description of blood circulation is Fabrizi. Fabrizi also became the chair of anatomy at Padua, and he published his small manuscript called the Venarum Osteolis on the ostium of the vein in 1603. And these drugs are also very important. And he was the first one who noted that there are thin little membranes on the inside of the veins distributed at intervals over the lambs. At times they are single, at times we find two of them together. Their mouths are directed toward the root of the vein, and in the other directions are closed. So what he did, the mistakes, and these are description of, you know, valves in the veins in the lower extremity, is that he did a mistake in terms of function of these valves. And he thought the function of these valves is basically to decelerate the blood motion toward the extremity so the blood doesn't accumulate in the lambs. And as you know, the venous circulation is the opposite. The blood comes toward the heart. And finally, this is the most important author in the history of medicine, and this book is the most important book in the history of medicine, is the Motu Cordis et Sanguinis in Animalibus, on the motion of the heart and blood in animals. And this is the work of William Harvey, who was a British physician who also studied in Padua in Italy. And he actually, based on several experimental physiology, described the blood motion and the blood circulation as we know it. The book is a small book. It's a big, basically 77 pages, has 17 chapters. The first chapter is the structure of the heart and the blood circulations. And the second part is on the circulatory circulation in the veins and the arteries. And has this one single drawing with the tourniquet around the arm showing that the venous blood goes from periphery to the heart and the arterial blood comes from the heart to the periphery. So there is a nice introduction on the function of the mitral valve. And just read the last sentence. He goes through all the descriptions based on Galen, and at the end he asks this question: good God, how should the mitral valves prevent the regurgitation of air and not of blood? Because we said air is coming through the left atrium and the mixture is going backward. And then he does also a lot of dissection, and he's considered the father of experimental physiology. And these are some of his observations from his book, is that the chief function of the heart is the transmission of pumping of the blood through the arteries to the extremities of the body. Thus, the pulse which we feel in the arteries is nothing else than the impact of blood from the heart. In the more perfect warm-blooded adult animals, as man, the blood passes from the right ventricle of the heart through the pulmonary artery to the lungs, from there through the pulmonary veins into the left auricle or atrium, and then into the left ventricle. It is obvious that blood enters the lamb through the arteries and returns through the veins, that the arteries are the vessels carrying blood from the heart and the veins the channels returning it to the heart. Harvey couldn't see the capillary system because at that time there was no microscope, but he figured out there is a connection between the arterial systems and the venous systems. This work was so revolutionary that multiple publishers, they refused to publish it. He has to go, the best publisher at that time, they were in Italy, in Venice, next to Padua. So he has to go to Germany. This book was published by a small publisher in Frankfurt. It has 248 mistakes in terms of spelling. And the other interesting thing is the quality of paper in Germany wasn't as good as in Italy. So most books from 15th or 16th or 17th century, if they're based in Italy, you can find good quality. But these books, based on a bad quality of paper, is extremely difficult to find. And the last time it was on the market, the first edition was about 35 years ago, was Laskell Norman, who put it on auction in Christie's. So he also did quantitative work in terms of showing that the blood is not sanitized in a continuous manner in the liver, that there is a circulation, and this is the text. I don't want to take too much of your time, but again, these texts are extremely known if you have an interest in the history of medicine. The last steps in terms of understanding the blood circulation is the works of Malpighi, who wrote two letters to one of his friends, who was Alfonso Borelli, and he's the father of histology on macroscopic histology, and he used magnifying lenses, and he studies the lungs of frogs, and these are the illustration, the first illustration that shows particularly on the right side the connection between the arterial and venous systems with the capillary network. And here is the text, just highlight the part that may be of interest to you. The blood is forced and scattered by the pulse through the arteries into a network. As the bloodstream does repeatedly divide it, it's carried round in a sinuous manner. Its color fades. It is thus distributed until it approaches the walls, receiving branches of the veins. So now you have the history of blood circulations. We know how the blood circulates. And then we have to focus a little bit on the pathology. The father of modern pathology is Jean-François Vernel. He wrote this important book in 1554 called Medicina. And he's basically the first author who coined the term physiology and pathology. And he's among the first author, which wasn't very common, to require an autopsy in each patient following the description of their clinical symptoms. And when these patients were dying, he was always requesting an autopsy to find the correlations between the clinical presentations and the autopsy findings. He doesn't have major contribution in valvular heart disease, but he has some description in terms of importance of syncope and in the patients with heart disease. And I think he has some description of syphilis and its relation to aneurysm of the arterial walls. So here comes the first description of valvular heart disease. Now let me ask the fellows, what were the most common causes of valvular disease? If you want to understand the history of medicine, you have to go backward. If you stay in your place and you want to read 400 years ago, that wouldn't be very interesting. You have to put yourself into their shoes, go back 300-400 years ago, and see how they could describe step by step what we know today. So what were the most important causes of valvular heart disease at that time?
Rheumatic?
Congenital.
Yeah?
Infectious.
Endocarditis. So there are three actually. It's rheumatic, endocarditis, and endocarditis in patients with rheumatic heart disease. That's what describes the struggle for 350 years to describe the anatomic lesions, because a significant number of these patients have both lesions and they couldn't figure it out what's what. So the first description of valvular disease comes from Lazare Riviere. It was described in 1646, reported on his Opera Medica, Opera Omnia, Opera Medica are collected works of authors. So for the first time it was described in 1674. And here is basically he followed young patients who had palpitations, who had irregular pulse. A few days later, the patient has dyspnea and swollen legs. Obviously, the patients have congestive heart failure. And he wrote, when the hand was applied over the region of the heart, a most rapid, weak, and irregular palpitation was felt. This patient deteriorated, and he passed away. And here is the description again. The patient seemed in extremis, great suffocation seized him, and there was no pulse in the arm, and it could be perceived only with difficulty in the heart. And this patient died, and here is the post-mortem examination. In the left ventricle of the heart, round carbuncles were found like the substance of the lungs, the larger of which resembled a cluster of hazelnut and filled up the opening of the aorta. So what is this? Is that endocarditis? Is that a yes, or is it a yes with endocarditis?
Endocarditis.
It is?
Yeah.
Endocarditis? This is a question of debate. Some historians think this is the first description, not that it's very important, but for historian it is important that this is the case of a yes. Some think this is the case of endocarditis. At least it is described as the first case of aortic valve endocarditis by most historians. The first description of valvular diseases are in patients with aortic valve disease. There are a few descriptions of mitral valve disease, but most of them are aortic valve disease. The second author is John Mayo. John Mayo, he's the father of respiratory physiology, and he was very close to identify oxygen. But he basically tried to purify air, and then he was injecting this purified solution into the venous blood and was saying it's getting red. But he couldn't figure it out what it is. He'd call it nitrile aero spirit. So, again, That was his contribution in respiratory physiology. But he also described a case of a patient who had the following presentation. Majority pericarditis, a young man who suffered from palpitation for several years. That was one of the most common signs of patients with valvular heart disease. And most authors recognize it because palpitations we know today is probably was atrial fibrillation, you know, as a clinical manifestation. And again, he wrote, if the hands were placed on the chest, the heart could be felt violently dashed against the thorax, and one could, so to speak, hold it in the hand. But yet the pulse of the arteries in the wrist was very languid. And this patient, he follows that, and the patient dies. And here is the description of the findings after a cardiac autopsy. And said the pulmonary artery and vein were distended, and the vein where it opens into the left ventricle of the heart were nearly closed by cartilage adhering to its interior. On the bottom, for as the blood could not, on account of the obstruction, pass into the left ventricle of the heart, the pulmonary blood vessels and also the right ventricle were necessarily distended with blood. That's very important. This is the first case of description of mitral stenosis. And he figured out, not as well as the next authors, that there's consequences on the circulation that precedes the left atrium. And he noticed that there are consequences on the pulmonary blood vessels and the right ventricle. Interestingly, this work wasn't known by the following authors. This work, the description of first mitral stenosis by Mayo, was known almost 100 years later. The authors that contributed, this is a very important book by Teofil Bonnet. It's called Sepulchratum Civia Anatomia. It was published in 1679. He was from Switzerland. And what he did, he looked at all the autopsy reports that were published in the literature. Basically, it's the first meta-analysis. It includes 3,000 case reports. They are quite well organized based on symptoms or based on organs. And there are one case of coronary artery obstruction and one case of aortic valve disease. And here is the description, which is very short, is a Parisian tailor, not yet old, having dined and left his house, had walked hardly 40 paces when he suddenly fell to the ground and expired. His body was open and no disease was found except that the trisomilenar cusp leading to the aorta of her body. So that's the case, first case of aortic valve stenosis. But he also didn't appreciate or the implications in terms of left ventricular hypertrophy and other things that go. But that's, again, considered the first description of aortic valve stenosis. Now, among others, because we're talking about clinical diagnosis, one of the important of clinical diagnosis is the pulse. And the father of the modern pulse is John Floyer. And as you can see, the title of his book is Physician's Pulse Watch, to explain the old art of feeling the pulse and to improve it by the help of a pulse watch. So the pulse was known, the irregular pulse, all those things are known from antiquarian medicine. But what he did, that he created a little device that allows you to calculate the pulse over a minute. So the average that he found was between 70 and 75, and the minimum pulse that he found was 55, the maximum was 132. He also looked at the difference of pulse by gender and by age. But there are not significant, you know, contribution in terms of valvular heart disease. Now, when you get to the 18th century, things accelerate. They become more specific. And the next two, three authors that I'm talking, these are really the father of cardiology or cardiac pathology. One of them is Raymond de Vieux-Sens, who wrote the first book in 1715 on cardiology. So that's the main historical contribution, is the first book on cardiology. He has multiple contributions. He describes very well the anatomy of coronary arteries, the coronary veins, the myocardial shape of the left and right ventricle. And in terms of valvular heart disease, he described the first detailed report on mitral valve stenosis. And this is the one that is known in the literature of medicine. because he describes again the clinical symptoms in detail, that I put some of them in terms of violent palpitation, small pulse, and swollen legs. And then the anatomic report, the autopsy report, is really detailed. And here you really have the detailed description of anatomic lesions of rheumatic mitral valve disease, and also the hemodynamic consequences. That's the first authors that details much more than John Mayo did, the consequences of the mitral stenosis in terms of dilatation of the left atrium, in terms of pulmonary congestions, in terms of dilatation of pulmonary arteries, and the right ventricle. The other important contribution of Viosans is these are the first illustration of mitral valve disease in the history. On the left side, you see the aspect of the fish mouth here. This is the orifice of the mitral valve. Here you see the dilatation of the posterior wall of the left atrium and the pulmonary veins. And the right side, you have a cross sections of the right ventricle, and you see the dilatation of the RV in patient who had mitral valve stenosis. Then we go to the next author, which is William Copper. He wrote a small article in Philosophical Transaction in 1706. It's called Of Ossification or Petrification in the Coat of Arteries, particularly in the valves of the great artery. And this is the first report of aortic valve regurgitation. And the text goes as follows: the three semilunar valves of the aorta, which hinder the blood from returning to the heart after it is expelled thence by its systole or contraction, these valves in this case were somewhat thicker and not so pliable as naturally, and didn't so adequately apply to each other. In this instance, I observed the left ventricle of the heart to be a little dilated from its natural size. The symptoms were extraordinary shortness of breath, the posture of sitting up, great faintness, pain about the heart, the extreme parts often cold. So basically, he described the low flow cardiac output in a patient who's in heart failure. And there are three illustrations of this case. This is a cross section that shows the thickened leaflet of the aortic valve. And on the bottom here, puts two leaflets with a nodule of calcifications in the commissures. The second author, which has also significant contribution in our understanding of heart disease, and particularly valvular heart disease, is Lancisi. He published two books. One is called On the Sudden Death on 1707, and the other book is called Domo to Cordis Aneurysmatibus. It is interesting that after the publications of Harvey books, which is called Domo to Cordis, a lot of authors who wrote about cardiology, they use this terminology on the motion of the heart. And at that time, the term aneurysmatibus was relating to the dilatation of the heart. It was an aneurysm of the heart, but dilatation of the heart. So Lancisi was a very known doctor in Rome, and there was an epidemic of sudden death in Rome in early 1700. And Pope Clement XI asked him to do an epidemiologic study and do autopsy of all these patients who have sudden death. So he reported a significant, you know, cardiac causes of sudden death. And as you can see here, they included vegetations of the heart valves. So there are description of cases of aortic valve endocarditis, obstruction of coronary artery disease, and arterial aneurysms. He also, in his second book, Domo to Cordis Aneurysmatibus, reported several cases of valvular heart disease, including MS and AS. And these are his propositions. The propositions are as follows. There are about 50 of them. I put just a few of them that relate to patients with valvular heart disease. That in patients with cardiac enlargement, dilatation affects more frequently the atria compared to the ventricles. He reported a case of ossification of the aortic valve and noted narrowing of the valve orifices created an obstacle that could lead to cardiac enlargement, which is correct. The obstruction of the left-sided valves would lead to the dilatation of right cardiac chambers, which is correct. Irregular pulse and syncope were two common manifestations of valvular disease. That is extremely correct. They're all from 1700. And then he described the first case of cardiac enlargement in a patient with tricuspid insufficiency. And he explained that the veined neck distension was a consequence of dilatation of right-sided cardiac chambers with significant tricuspid regurgitation, which is called Lancisi's sign, which was discovered 200 years later by McKenzie, who used a polygraph to measure the dilatation of the pulmonary of the vein in the neck. And that's the little image on the right side is a woodcut that demonstrates this case of tricuspid insufficiency with the dilatation of the right ventricle and tricuspid annulus. Then we go to the next author, who is Jean-Baptiste de Senac. De Senac was a very famous physician at the Royal Court of France. He was a physician of Louis XIV. And he published this treatise. This is the first treatise in cardiology. It's a two-volume book. It was close to 1,400 pages. It has the anatomy of fetal cardiac anatomy, adult cardiac anatomy, blood circulations, all kinds of description of diseases. But he has significant contribution, which are as the following. First, his descriptions of structure of the heart with these illustrations from Antoine Portal. Antoine Portal was an anatomist, one of the most famous in the 18th century. And these descriptions of cardiac valves are very accurate. And most of these drawings are those that we currently use to draw the different aspects of the heart. He have the cross-section of the left ventricle on the right side, the ventricular view of the mitral valve. He described the primary cordae. He described the secondary cordae of the mitral valve. And he described the relationship between the mitral valve and the aortic valve. And this is a very first time that this aspect of the aortic valve, the conjunction with the mitral valve, was described. In terms of observation in terms of valvular heart disease, he is among the first that noted that the semilunar valve, that means the aortic valve, was more affected than the mitral valve in patients with mitral valve with valvular heart disease. And he's the one who, for the first time, used the term of cardiac asthma and recognized that the cardiac asthma, orthopnea, and lower extremity edema were all from cardiac origins. So another interesting finding, this nobody knows. Like this is, so anybody is interested, you can write an article about that because he's really considered one of the most famous physicians of 18th century. And his book is among the top 50 books of the 18th century, but nobody probably has read the entire book. And people give credit for James Hope for describing the first case of mitral regurgitation, not mitral stenosis. And he actually described a nice case of mitral regurgitation. And he concludes that although you may have mitral stenosis or mitral regurgitation, the consequences are the same in terms of left atrium and the pulmonary circulation, which is a true finding. And I can read it for you. So that after the ossification and retraction of mitral leaflets, the blood regurgitates into the left atrium, leading to the dilatation of this chamber. Subsequently, the orifice of the mitral valve enlarges, and additional blood enters the left ventricle, which would then cause ventricular dilatation. He concluded that if the mitral valve orifice stays open entirely or partially, that would have the same drawbacks as if the mitral orifice was narrowed. In both cases, blood accumulates in the atrial chamber, forcing its walls and leading to its distension. Now, there are some parts of Senac's book that are translated in English, some parts are not. And that part, this is my translation, because it's not known in the literature, because they don't give credit to him for description of mitral regurgitation. But again, this is something publishable. Then we get to 1765. This guy is the god of anatomopathology. His name is Morgagni. He's from Italy. He was in Bologna and published his book in 1761. And it's called On the Siege and Causes of Diseases. And this is the first author who basically, although everybody else was doing it, some of them before, who basically does an institution of clinical anatomical correlation. His book has close to 700 case reports, all based on his own experience. And he described these cases in detail. And for each patient, you have an autopsy report. And this is basically considered the third most important book in the history of medicine. And again, it's divided in five sections: head, thorax, abdomen. And he describes several cases of ossifications of cardiac valves involving the aortic and the mitral valve, and a case of aortic valve endocarditis. The influence of Morgagni was huge, because actually this anatomical clinical correlations is widely spread in 19th century. Most authors of 19th century do this autopsy after their patient dies, and it's very important because it's mostly based on his work. So at the same year, there is this guy, Leopold Oehlenberger. He publishes this book on a new invention. It's called Inventum Novum, which is on percussion. So interestingly, this guy is from the School of Vienna, which was one of the best medical schools at that time in Europe. And he's a physician and also a musician. His father has an inn, and they have a barrel of wine in the basement. And in order to check the level of the wine, he was tapping on the barrel. And he thought that would be a good thing to do to see if the patients have effusions around their heart or around their chest. So he started doing that, and he published his experiences. It's a small book. It was very difficult to find on the market until 10, 15 years ago. Now you can find it more easily. It's 85 pages. And then here you have a few description of cases in patients who have empyema, pericardial pleural effusion, and enlargement of the heart. Now, this technique, although was supported by some authors in late 1700, didn't get popularity until early 1900, when Corvisart, the physician of Napoleon, popularized it. And from, let's say, early 1900 to the discovery of chest X-ray, percussion was the technique that they were used to estimate this increase in the size of the heart. Then we get to this author from England. You may have heard Annie from his name. Is Matthew Bailey. Matthew Bailey was the niece of Hunter brothers. And he wrote the first systematic study of pathology in English language. So that's the first book where cardiac diseases are reported in English language. The first edition came in 1793, was translated in the United States in 1795. And there is basically a section on diseased appearance of the pericardium. Then he described the cases of pericarditis, as well as cases of calcifications or bony transformations affecting the aortic and mitral valves. There are not significant original contribution, except of the fact that in the second edition of the book, he relates the rheumatic fever to the affections of pericardium. And he has a second book, which is called A Series of Engraving, accompanied with explanations which are intended to illustrate the morbid anatomy of some of the most important parts of the body. And that has basically a section of heart, and this is the first atlas of cardiac pathology. And there are this drawing, which is very well known by historians in cardiology, the first illustration of pericarditis with thickened pericardium, as you can see on the bottom right. The legends are on the right side, if you would like to read. And then he reports five cases of valvular heart disease. They involve the three top, the aortic valve. As you can see, you have leaflet perforations in the two top ones, but the leaflets look also thickened, so they can be cases of rheumatic heart disease or rheumatic heart disease complicated with endocarditis. The middle case look like a calcified case of aortic valve. This one is the case of mitral valve, probably endocarditis. And this is the first illustration of a bicuspid aortic valve. It was initially described 30 years later by his, wasn't described, was that comes from Hunter's collection. And Hunter refers to this disease in 1764. But the first illustration is in the book of his nephew. Then we progress and we get to 19th century. So 19th century, there are a few names, but one of the most important is Corvisart. He really wrote the most important book in cardiology after Dussenac, which makes it almost 50 years later. And he was a physician of Napoleon Bonaparte, and he was extremely respected in Europe. He has multiple contribution in cardiovascular medicine, and his initial book was describing was published in 1806, and these are some of his observation. He describes several cases of mitral stenosis. The first detailed description of tricuspid valve stenosis. He also mentioned that the left-sided valves are more affected than the right-sided valve, which is correct, and we know it is correct. And he is the one who, although Lancisi years ago mentioned the dilatation of the heart, he introduced the concept of active aneurysm, which was the thickening of the muscle of the heart, which equivalent of hypertrophy later on, or passive aneurysm, which is a dilatation of the heart. So he described basically two types of congestive heart failure with the introduction of this concept of active and passive aneurysms. And he main contribution in mitral valve disease is the physical signs of mitral valve disease, which is the palpable pericardial thrill that was first described by him in 1806. And here the following is the text. There is a certain thrill, or bruissement in the French word, difficult to describe, perceptible when the hand is applied to the pericardial region. A thrill which comes without doubt from the difficulty which the blood finds in passing through an orifice which is not large enough for the quantity of blood which is supposed to let pass. Another contribution of Corvisart is the introduction of the term vegetation. He, as we said, a lot of the patients may have rheumatic fever or endocarditis or a combination. His text here focuses on several cases of pure endocarditis, and he is the first author. He reported a case of mitral valve endocarditis with rupture of multiple chordae of the anterior leaflet. And he describes the phenomenon of mitral regurgitation in the setting of mitral valve endocarditis. And as you can see in his text, he clearly defined that compared to the calcified aspergillitis. I think the texting is here, that he really makes a distinction between the soft vegetation and this bony transformations of the cardiac valves. And he also is among the first to describe several cases of papillary muscle rupture, which are probably post-traumatic. And the chapter is called Partial Rupture of the Heart, and they're all focuses on the papillary muscle ruptures. And then he publishes the work of Oenberger into French in 1808. And here is into the introduction of his book. And he had his own experience of percussion in patients with heart disease. And here, as it reads, I could have raised myself to the rank of an author by revamping the work of Oenberger and publishing a work on percussion. But by that, I would sacrifice the name of Oenberger to my own vanity that I don't wish to do. It belongs to him. It is his beautiful and rightful discovery, inventum novatum, as he just says, which I wish to bring to life. So that contribution of this translation, this contribution of Corvisart basically introduces the percussion as a technique in the diagnosis of not only cardiac diseases, but also abdominal diseases. And as I said, that technique was used until the discovery of the X-ray to measure the size of the heart and its enlargement. Then we get to 1809, and you have this guy, Alan Burns. Alan Burns published the first book in English language. He wasn't a doctor. He was working with his brother, who was John Adams. John Adams was a doctor. So he was assisting his brother. He was following them in the clinics or with his friends. And when these patients were dead, he was doing the autopsies. So the brother didn't write the book, he wrote the book, but he's not a doctor. So again, it's a beautiful book, has multiple sections on the diseases of the heart. One of his main contributions also, he describes more in detail the calcification of the coronary arteries, but he also has a good number of contributions in valvular heart disease. He's among the first, and he's probably the first author to describe a large left atrial thrombus in the setting of mitral valve stenosis. And here is the text. The left auricle contained a concretion larger than a pigeon's egg. The substance was of an irregular round form. It appeared as if it had been composed of several portions forcibly pressed together. So he also described one of the first cases of combined or double valve disease, aortic and mitral valve disease. And he also recognized in a patient who predominantly has mitral regurgitation, the sensation of there was a jarring when the ventricles contracted and when the hand was laid on the side. This is almost the same thing that the pericardial thrill that was described 2-3 years earlier by Corvizar. And again, I'm focusing, because with the history, you can go all over the places, it can be endless. I'm just focusing on clinical diagnosis. And as you can see, most of these authors had a good knowledge in 18th and 19th century in terms of clinical presentation, whether it's dyspnea with shortness of breath, lower extremity edema, irregular pulse. Hemoptysis was also well described at that time. The pulse was now well studied in terms of clinical diagnosis. The percussion was well developed. And we get to this, early stages of 19th century with the contribution of Laennec. So Laennec was a pupil of Corvizar and basically invented the stethoscope in 1816. So the version which is officially accepted that there was a lady with large breasts in his office and he was intimidated to listen to the heart using his ears. He didn't want to have a direct contact. So he took a piece of paper and rolled it and used that to listen to the heart sounds. And then that leads to the construction of the stethoscope. The first stethoscope were two pieces. They were based on wood, as you can see here. And then that was from 1817 to 21. And from 1821 afterwards, he based his construction on two pieces stethoscope. And Dennis, who helped me yesterday to put all this talk together, asked me to brought this stethoscope. This is a three-wood stethoscope that belongs actually to Laennec himself. And he gave it generation by generation to several physicians in France. So this is the fourth piece of physical examination in patients with valvular heart disease, which is the use of a stethoscope. Now, similar to the description of anatomic lesions, which are complicated, the description of cardiac sounds were also very complicated because a significant number of these patients, as we know today, they have the mixed disease. You can have MS and MR, you can have AS and AI. So how we know what is what? So, Laennec describes several types of cardiac, bruit. Bruit de souffle, which goes, like a bellows, that mostly goes with diastolic murmurs. He described bruit de scie or sawing, rasping. These are harsh sounds that goes mostly with aortic valve stenosis. And he's like musical or hissing bellows that goes, with the vascular systems. The problem was that Laennec didn't appreciate the timing of cardiac sounds. He thought, he obviously described two sounds, but he thought the first sounds were the contraction of the ventricles and the second sound was the contraction of the atriums. Now, in order to understand the cycle or the research that went through to understand or to describe accurately cardiac murmurs, it took about 8 years. That started in 1816. It goes original publication in terms of describing cardiac murmurs goes up to 1895. So Laennec's books, once he was alive, went through four editions. At the end of the fourth edition, the fourth edition contains correct description of cardiac sounds. But the first edition, obviously, they are not correct. So one thing I didn't put here, but it has already contribution of valve disease, but it's not the most significant. The next author, it's really James Hope. James Hope wrote a book in 1832. He learned auscultations from Laennec himself, and Laennec used to appreciate his pupils. So his evaluation was very serious, student, excellent. So he went back to England and he started doing experimental work with Williams. He actually described the correct contribution of cardiac sounds. And the way they did it, the first sounds they described, by they used animal models and they put the little hook in the ascending aorta and they make the aortic valve incompetent. And they saw when the aortic valve is incompetent, the second sound goes away. And then, so the first murmur that were easier to describe was the systolic murmur aortic of pulmonary stenosis. And here is really, now we have books in English, I put you the text from the original book. And you can, I read it for you, but I wish somebody with a better accent could have read it. It said, a slight patescence of the valve admitting of regurgitation may result from a structural lesion not sufficient to present an obstacle to the blood flowing in its natural direction from the auricle into the ventricle, as that, for instance, from a contraction of the cordae tendineae, preventing the margin of the valve from coming in perfect apposition. So that's the first case of mitral valve regurgitation due to the cordae shortening. And then it follows, and in this way is to be explained a phenomenon which I have frequently noticed, namely that a murmur from regurgitation sometimes accompanies the first sound but none attends the second. So that's the first original, you know, description of the systolic murmur of mitral valve regurgitation. And then he describes his cases of valve disease. And here, I really think it's magical. It's because this circumstance appeared to me to be the changed form of the ventricle. For as in hypertrophy with dilatation, the cavity is more spherical than natural. And these are the two drawings, a natural shaped ventricle, a rounded one. Just to emphasize, within the late 1980s and early 1990s, echocardiographer, they introduced the concept of sphericity, saying in patients with heart failure, you have the elliptical shapes that become spherical. And I think one of our colleagues who have a great interest in valvular heart disease goes to meeting and he put a football balloon, American football balloon on one side, and he put a basketball balloon on the left side, and says, here, this is normal heart, this is dilated heart, find MR, fix MR. So it was done in 1832, close to 200 years ago. So as I said, this description of valvular heart disease and the cardiac murmurs span over a period of 280 years. And one of the problems that we had with mitral stenosis, what could it be? Why did the cardiac murmur of MS can be more complicated than other ones to be diagnosed or to be recognized?
Sorry, what was the question?
Why the murmur of MS is more difficult to be determined from, again, from their perspective historically compared to the other diseases?
Isn't diastolic, like rumble?
Yes, first is diastolic is more difficult to hear. The second thing is that it depends if you are in sinus rhythm or FM. You have a presystolic reinforcement in patients who are in sinus rhythm, which disappeared if you are in atrial fibrillation. But nobody knows at that time atrial fibrillation. They knew irregular pulse, but so there is a debate because these different doctors are hearing different noises. And it goes for 50 years and almost 9 or 10 authors that are debating, their conferences debating, like, what is the murmur of MS? And there is a guy in France that actually has 4 cases when they're all in sinus rhythm. And he documented that, like, if you have a regular pulse, this presystolic reinforcement, if you don't have it, it disappears. And that was published in 1855. And that's one of the first authors that correlate or the diseases of the valve with rheumatic heart disease. And finally, I go to this author, Buyo, who was also a pupil of Laennec. He had multiple contributions, and among his first contribution is he's the first author who did accurate measurements of the sizes of cardiac valves. I just put two pages. This goes like for 200 pages. He measured the circumferences of all four valves, the height of all the leaflet, the thickness of all the leaflets. He did that in patients who have normal valves, normal heart, dilated heart, or something that he called atrophic heart, which is not very clear. He introduced or coined the term endocardium and the inflammation of the endocardium, endocarditis. And he's the first one who attempted to describe the pathophysiology of endocarditis. And he described three phases, a period of sanguinary congestions, of softening, of ulceration and suppuration, period of organization of secreted products of a portion of fibrinous concretions, and period of cartilaginous or osseous or calcareous induration. And as you can see, that can go with acute, subacute, and chronic endocarditis. But also, it can be the first one, it can be a case of infective endocarditis. And the third, it can be a case of rheumatic heart disease. Because, again, there was no distinction between these two entities, between these two etiologies at that time. This book is very well known, although he wasn't the first one to make the correlation between rheumatic heart disease and rheumatic fever and valvular heart disease. He basically reported about 150 cases of patients who had rheumatic fever and developed valvular heart disease. And he has an extensive description of clinical symptoms and autopsy findings. So basically, that's the conclusion of his book, that in the great majority of cases of acute articular rheumatism with fever, there exists in a variable degree a rheumatism of the serofibrous tissues of the heart. This coincidence, at that time the coincidence in its meaning was simultaneous occurrence, then is the rule and the non-coincidence the exception. So he's the one who really showed there is a relationship with rheumatic fever and valvular heart disease. Then the first, until I would say 1900, 60 years, there are two focus. One is to better understand the cardiac murmurs to be more accurate in terms of diagnosis of the patient with valvular heart disease. And the second one is the etiologic approach to separate rheumatic fever from endocarditis. And at that time, at least in mid-1800s, there was no germ theory of disease. The work of Louis Pasteur came in 1852, that there are, you know, microorganisms that can affect the body and cause infection. And the Gram staining came in 1872. So the really diagnosis of infective endocarditis, to be more accurate, was based on the work of Osler and two other authors, including Liebman from here, that determined the fate of these two diseases. So it went up to 1900. And rheumatic fever, you needed immunology. It was in 1927. So the next 78 years were cardiac murmurs and etiology. But that requires a different talk because they're all very long. Thank you very much.